You would also notice that this talk has zero Serif typefaces. So, anyway, 1,489 days. This is how much time passed between Dan and Abramov. Showed the first preview of what back then was called time slicing, and the React 18th release, which finally made these capabilities available for everyone. In these 1,489 days, time slicing went through a whole lot of rebrandings, several API changes, and today became known as concurrent rendering. Now, my question to you, who here already uses React 18 on their production projects? Ooh, quite a few people. What about React 17? Even less people. What about 16? Anyone with 16? Oh, OK. Hold there. What about React 19? Anyone? No people with time machines. OK. Anyway, so if you've upgraded to React 18, you might have already seen its new features. If you haven't, then the concurrent rendering name might sound scary. But that's OK. What's actually new, performance-wise, in React 18 is just three new things. It's the new hooks, like use transition and use deferred value. It's some hydration improvements around suspense. And it's better batching of updates, like when you call set state or like dispatch and reduce several times in a row. So working with all these things, especially with stuff like use transition, might sometimes feel like magic. So today, I want to show you what actually happens in the app whenever you use the most foundational performance feature, use transition, and how React achieves its magic, which is actually not magic at all. So, well, let's dive into use transition, use deferred value, and to do that, let me show you a slow app. Oops, it's a different screen. Hold on. Yes. And this is going to be awkward. I'll have to stand like this. Anyway, so this is a basic note-taking app. Like, you have a list of notes. You could, like, click them. You could type something into them. Hello, Freiburg. Am I typing this well? No, I'm typing this terribly. You could create a new note, and you could filter notes. And the filtering notes is a pretty slow action. Like, you see this spinner in the top right corner, which is like spins forever. This is not actually a spinner. There's no data loading. What this spinner shows you, because you can't type on my keyboard, because you can't feel when the laptop is when my laptop is slow, what the spinner shows you when the page freezes. So if I type a single letter into the filter inputs, you would see that the spinner freezes for a second. Like, I type a letter, the spinner freezes, the spinner lags. I remove a letter, the spinner lags again. This is like, you could use this as a visual indicator of, OK, everything's terrible. And yeah, so like the filter input is, it's slow. It feels slow if I'm typing into it, or you could see that it's slow thanks to the spinner. But if I try to type a bunch of letters at once, it would kind of lag. And so, OK, so we have a performance issue. And the first thing that I do whenever I have a performance issue is I open Chrome DevTools, and I try to profile that issue in the performance pane. So let's try just that. I'm opening Chrome DevTools. I'm switching to the performance pane. I'm clicking Record. I'm reproducing my performance issue, which is I'm typing a single letter into this slow filter input. And I'm stopping the recording. And so in the recording, I could see quite a few things. I could see that we have a single spike of CPU activity. I could see this in the CPU row. It's the row that, like, whenever this row is filled, you know that the browser is busy doing something. And if I zoom into this spike of CPU activity and look into the main pane, I would see all the functions, all the things that happened in the browser when this spike of CPU happened. So I would zoom into this main pane, and I would look what's happening here, and I would see that the first thing that happened was the key press event, because I typed into the input there. That thing called the text input event, that called the input event, triggered the input event. The input event, in turn, called the dispatch discrete event function. And this function, if I open the summary pane, if I look at the functional location, I would see that this function comes from React DOM development. So it's a React function. And so the dispatch discrete event function calls discrete events, which is another React function that calls discrete updates $1, run with priority 1. And so it calls a whole lot. There's like a huge chain of React functions all the way to the bottom, like a lot of levels, all the way until we scroll like all the way down and notice functions having a different color. And color in this case means just that the function is coming from a different file. It doesn't, like, blue doesn't mean anything significant, pink doesn't mean anything significant. It's just functions coming from different files. And so if I like scroll through this whole array of React functions and look into what's happening here, I would see that the functions that are getting called here are functions like notes list, rec markdown, again, rec markdown, bunch of functions, and all these functions, like if I were a developer, I would recognize this, all these functions, look, they're my React components. So here's what's happening here. If I was to profile this a bit more, if I was to figure out a bit more what's happening here, I would realize this. So what happens is I'm typing into the text field that calls the setFilter function that changes the state. The state change changes the state in a bunch of components, like sidebar, filter input, et cetera, et cetera. And that, in turn, causes React to render all these components, one by one, until React is done. Is that a poem? Maybe. This re-rendering is a stop-the-word operation. Nothing can happen until React is done with rendering the components. The page, while React is rendering the components, the page is completely frozen. So if a user tries to interact with the app in any way, while React is busy rendering stuff, the user will have to wait until the re-render is done. And if rendering the app takes 2 seconds, then the user will have to wait for 2 seconds. This is how React 17 works, React 16 works, and React 18 works out of the box. Now, cool. Let's take a step back. We have a performance issue, right? I'm not noticing you. No, all right, that's rude. yeah. Anyway, let's take a step back. So we have a slow app. We have a performance issue. I'm typing into the text field, right? And that causes a bunch of components to render. And this render is blocking and expensive, which slows the app and the whole typing process and makes the app just unpleasant. So we can actually, one thing, another thing, whoa, that's a lot of errors. another thing that I could do, by the way, is I could go to the components pane, which is the pane provided by React DevTools, and I could open settings, and I can click this checkbox, highlight updates when components render. And if I do this, I would see, like, every time something would change in the app, I would see all the components that are, did I check that? Is it highlighting? It's not. Maybe I didn't check that. Oh, maybe I need to reload. I don't typically, but. Oh, yeah, of course. Thank you. Yeah, so assuming I keep the DevTools open, if I try typing into the field, I would see all the components re-rendering in the app. So like I type into the field, and I see that the field renders, and a bunch of node buttons renders. Like these buttons that open nodes, they also render. So like I type, and I see like the whole list renders. I remove a letter, and again, the whole list renders. I type more, and again, like a bunch, a whole lot of stuff in this sidebar renders, which is mostly these node buttons. So my question to you, if you were a React developer in this project, a React 17 developer, how would you solve this? What would you do? There are multiple ways to solve this, and what would you try? Debounce, yes, great optimization. Other ideas? Yes, you could memoize the components. If the component is rendering unnecessarily, you could wrap it with a React memo. Yeah, go ahead. What, sorry? Delay on input. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's so that's throttling or debouncing. And yeah, it is a very common optimization. And it's a good one. Any other suggestions? Ideas? Cool. So yeah, there are indeed a bunch of optimizations that I could apply here. I could wrap the component with React memo, which would prevent it from rendering if it was rendered unnecessarily. I could optimize the component, like if the component takes a while to render, I would go into it and figure out why. I could virtualize the list, like meaning if you look at the list, oops, spoilers. If you look at the list, we would see that like the list has a whole lot of not buttons, but only like 5 or 10 of them are visible at any point of time on the screen. So what's one thing I can do is I could, why render the whole list if I can only render the visible components? And by the way, Tanjis will have a talk about virtualization tomorrow. So do check it out. You could debounce or throttle, as some folks suggested. And yeah, so these all are great solutions. And you can even combine them. But what React 18 does is it introduces another solution to this mix, which is making updates non-urgent. Let's see how this works. So with React 17 and below, every update that happens in the app is considered urgent. This means that if you click a button, React would render everything immediately. If you type into the text field like I am doing, React would have to render the whole list of nodes immediately. With React 18, however, your updates can now have a priority. So every update by default, every update that you're doing in the app by default is still urgent. But what React now also supports is non-urgent updates. And non-urgent updates, they don't block the page, no matter how long they take. Let's see how this works. So I'm going to switch to the code again. And I'm going to zoom in a bit, hide this, zoom more. Yeah, I don't need to zoom in there. So look, here's the code for my sidebar component, for this yellow component that I have on the side of the app. What I have in this component is I have three child components. I have the filter input component, which renders the filter input. I have the notes list component, which renders the notes list. And I have the node controls component, which renders a bunch of buttons. And another thing this component has is a single bit of state called filter. And so the single bit of state called filter, it is updated every time I'm typing into the filter input. And it controls both the filter input and the nodes list. So every time I'm typing into the filter input, my filter input renders, and my nodes list renders. So, okay. Now, one thing React 18 introduces is non-urgent updates. And to start applying these optimizations, I needed to tune my mental model a bit. I needed to learn to look at the app and try to figure out, okay, which of these components need to be updated immediately, urgently, synchronously, and which of these components could be updated non-urgently, like in not blocking the page with like a delay. And so if I look at this app, I would realize that in this case, This state controls two components, right? It controls the filter input, and it controls the nodes list. But what actually happens here is the filter input component is the component that needs to update immediately. Like every time I'm typing into the editor, I need into the input, I need the input to update immediately because like otherwise the app would feel laggy. But the nodes list thing, it doesn't need to update right away. It could lag. Like I'm as a user is like perfectly okay with the filter list lagging a second after my input if the app stays responsive. Like I'm good with that. And so the way you would typically implement this optimization is indeed with debouncing and throttling. You would wrap your input event with like lodash.debounce or lodash.throttle, and you would make sure it runs less frequently. But what React allows you to do is React gives you another primitive for implementing a better optimization, an optimization that doesn't have drawbacks of debouncing and throttling. And this primitive is non-urgent updates. So to use non-urgent updates, I need to do two things. The first thing is I need to take my single state, and I need to split it into two states. One of these states would be urgent, and the other of these states would be non-urgent. So I'd call the first state filter input. And I would call the second state, the set filter input. All right, this is going to be slow. Ooh, I'm bad with keyboards. The second state would be called filter value and set filter value. And now the filter input would be passed into the filter input component, and the filter value will be passed into the nodes list component. And I would also call both set state hooks whenever I am, wrong line, whenever the text input updates. And one more thing, let's upgrade to React team. If only it was so easy. So now we have the app running in the React team mode. And if I try typing into the editor, into the filter input, it would still feel slow. Like I try typing, and look, it's laggy. It's like the spinner still lags, and if I try to type a bunch of letters, it would get slow and stuff. So we didn't do anything yet. We just duplicated the state, and we made our app worse. But what I can do now is I could take the second set state call, and I could wrap it with a function called start transition. And by doing this, I would tell React that, look, the set state call is not urgent. So what you could do, React, is you could take the set state call, and you could run it without blocking the page. And let's see how this works. So I apply this. Oh, no, hold on. I need the start transition function from somewhere, right? So I could import it straight from React. This would work. Or I could use the hook use transition, which like has one minor benefit. It also gives you, it also lets you to learn when the component is transitioning. It's pending, start transition equals use transition. So start transition is a function that you wrap your state updates into. And is pending is a thing that you could, I don't know, tune the app to show that the app is transitioning, that this like something is lagging behind. Like me setting opacity here. And so let's see how this works now. So pay attention to the spinner. I'm typing, and the spinner doesn't lag. So the whole list of components renders. I could even open DevTools to show you. The whole list of components renders, and this takes for a second. This like it lags by a second. It takes a second for it to render, but the spinner does not lag. I can type a bunch of letters, and like this would still be responsive. This would update immediately. Can remove everything, and it would like look. I'm typing it. It's almost like magic. It's so super cool. So, okay, Now, could anyone who doesn't know how this works guess how this works? How does React run that super expensive update without blocking the page for a whole second? Yeah, go ahead. Yes, right direction. Oh, almost there, almost the answer. Any other guesses? Any other ideas? Yeah, go ahead. It is suspense rendering. But yeah, how exactly does it work? But what does it mean? Yes. So, all right, we are getting there. Okay. So, the answer, the way this works is, sorry, wrong slide. The way this works is given. React is given back control to the browser after every frame. Let's see how this works. React. This is important. React is given back control to the browser after every frame. Let's see how this looks in DevTools. So I switch back to the app, and I click record again, and I try typing into the filter, and I stop recording. And now I still see a single expensive spike of CPU activity. But if I zoom into this spike, if I look into what's happening here, instead of a single huge JavaScript task, and let me remind you how this was before we implemented this optimization. So I'm going to comment this out and click record. Hold on, let me remove this. Click record, press F, stop recording. So before, this looked like this. We were pressing a keyboard letter, the keyboard button, and this was triggering the whole app to render. And this is blocking the page for 600 milliseconds. Now, with concurrent rendering, what happens is instead of blocking the page, instead of having a single huge expensive chunk of JavaScript which renders all your components in a row, what you have is you have these single, small, individual, small tasks of JavaScript, each of which takes just 5, 6, 7 milliseconds. And each of which renders just several components at times. So like we have a function call, and the function call renders React Markdown, calls React Markdown, calls React Markdown, a bunch of React Markdown components. And yeah, the nodes list components. So React starts rendering the components, React renders some components, and then React gives back control to the browser. So this is how it looks. Now, how does it actually work? So here's how concurrent rendering conceptually works under the hood. React has a queue of updates. Every time you're calling set state or something that does not update the app immediately, that first pushes the update into the queue. In our case, this queue has components that don't need to be updated urgently. It's node list and a bunch of node buttons and a bunch of React Markdown components. Then, React also has a function called perform work until deadline. This function takes the update queue and just processes the queue one by one. Now, in React 17, this was pretty much it. You would start processing the queue and you would keep processing the queue until you're done. All this time, the thread would be blocked. If you have 500 components to render, the page would be blocked until you render all 500 components. But React 18 added two critical changes. First, in the while loop, it added a check called calling the function should yield to host, which this function tells React whether it should give the control back to the browser. And second, after the loop is done, React now checks whether there are still any pending unprocessed updates and schedules another perform work until deadline function to execute in the next frame. So that's how it works conceptually under the hood. Now, the should yield to host function, the function that decides when React should return control back to the browser, it's basically one-liner. It returns true. It simply returns true when the current render has been taken more than 5 milliseconds. And the schedule perform work until deadline function, the function that schedules the next 5 millisecond chunk of JavaScript activity, is also pretty simple. Microtasks. So in environments like Node.js, it simply calls setImmediate. In older browsers, it calls setTimeout with a zero delay. This, simply speaking, schedules the function to run in the next frame. And in modern browsers, it creates a new message channel object and posts a message through it. And this basically works just like setTimeout, with the only difference that it avoids the minimum delay that setTimeout introduces. And that's pretty much it. So if you remember this slide from the past, this is how React 17 behaved when I tried typing into the filter field. I typed into the field that changed the state in a bunch of components, and React rendered all components in a single pass. Now, with React 18, this changes. When I try typing into the field, React calls setFilterInput and then immediately calls setFilterValue. So even though the setFilterValue function is wrapped with startTransition, it is still called immediately. Like, startTransition does not delay this call at all. It just calls the callback pretty much immediately. So React calls both functions. That causes the state to update in a bunch of components. But now, some of these state updates are urgent, whereas other state updates are marked as not. And so what React now does is it takes the urgent updates and it renders them in the old blocking manner. But then it takes the list of non-urgent updates and it starts rendering them in a non-blocking manner, giving the control back to the browser every 5 milliseconds. And so now, if the user tries to click something during rendering, the click would be handled pretty much immediately, no matter when the click happens. Before every non-urgent render would typically be blocking the main thread for only 5-10 milliseconds. This is React 18's concurrent rendering, and this is how it works under the hood. Now, drawbacks, because there's no free lunch. The first drawback of this whole behavior is that non-urgent updates take a bit longer. React has to yield back to the browser every time a frame ends, every time 5 milliseconds pass. And that introduces some delays. So if I switch to Chrome DevTools, and if I compare, the time it took for the list to render in the blocking version, that was 600 milliseconds, versus non-blocking version, this took, I can't see it. This took 900 milliseconds. So like, the numbers like, would vary every time. It's not always like half of 30 milliseconds longer, like 50% longer. Sometimes it's just a little. But what you see in this case, when the update was urgent, the list of nodes rendered faster, sooner. And when the update was non-urgent, it took more time for React to finish rendering the whole list and to display the result on the screen. So non-urgent updates take a bit longer. Now, this would hopefully maybe be solved with this different shoot yield to host implementation, which is currently behind the flag. So today, as we talked, shoot yield to host is basically a one-liner. It checks whether 5 milliseconds has passed, and React gives the control back to the browser every 5 milliseconds. The implementation that's currently behind the flag is more sophisticated. Specifically, instead of just yielding to the browser every 5 milliseconds, it checks whether the user has tried interacting with the app while the app was blocked, and yields back only if the user did, or if the render was taking more than 300 milliseconds. This should reduce the number of switching between the browser and React a lot. And This also relies on one of my favorite lesser-known browser APIs called Navigator Scheduling Isinput Pending. So Isinput Pending is a function that you could call at any moment while running any JavaScript. And this function would return true if like, you were running some JavaScript and the user tried interacting with the app during this time. The function would return true that, look, there's some input pending. So if you're, I don't know, mining some bitcoins, whatever, this is probably an old joke already, Bitcoin is cheap. But you would want to keep the page response if you could check this function from time to time and give the control back to the browser, stop mining when there's some input pending. Unfortunately, this function is currently Chromium only. It was shipped in Chromium 87. It's currently only supported in Chromium 87 and more. So this is the first drawback. Non-urgent updates take longer. It might be kind of fixed with the new shoot-ilto host, but it relies on Chromium-only APIs for now. Then, the second drawback is that the extra complexity doesn't come for free. So to make the concurrent rendering possible, React had to make its architecture much more complex. It introduced React Fiber, it introduced a bunch of concurrent rendering checks, and all this stuff takes a toll on the bundle and on the CPU. In fact, this is actually one of the reasons Vue and Preact straight refused to implement anything similar to concurrent rendering. Both Vue and Preact believe that it's unlikely that any real-world apps would benefit from concurrent features. Like Preact says, for example, it's still up in the air whether concurrent mode is something that benefits apps at all, even for React. Or Evan Yu from Vue.js even wrote a detailed opinion on how React basically invented an overly expensive scheduler and now tries to fix it with this like even more overly expensive engineering and stuff. So you'll find the link here. And yeah, like one of the things he says is that, look, the demo React team showcases is so contrived that it would likely never happen in an actual app. So yeah, the React team, however, seems to play a long game, and it's explicit about it. Mostly on Twitter, though, because that's apparently where the documentation lives nowadays. But one thing the React team has been working on is, and one thing the concurrent features will unlock, is the upcoming off-screen API. The off-screen API, which is like not the final API, it's not a real API, just some stuff mentioned in discussions and on GitHub and stuff. The off-screen API will allow to pre-render stuff like inactive routes, tabs, etc. in the background, so that when you click a link from like the root page to the profile, the switch would happen literally instantly. React would need just to hide one DOM node with the visible page and show another DOM node with the profile page, and then run the effects. So this off-screen API pre-renders inactive parts of the app in the background, and it does this using the same mechanism the use transition view uses and the same mechanism suspense uses. So, yep. What about my opinions about this disagreement? Honestly, I'm just watching. So, yeah, and by the way, you might notice that all these discussions are from 2019, 2020, which is when React introduced, well, was demoing everything. There haven't been any changes since then. So React continued pursuing this like long-term vision, and Vue and Preact still don't see any value in implementing time slicing, which is concurrent rendering, which is concurrent modes. So yeah, there's another last drawback slash pitfall. React concurrency doesn't help to optimize expensive components. So if you look at the React rendering loop again, this perform work until deadline function, you'll notice that the shoot ill to host function is called only after every render. You have this perform unit of work function here. And this function takes one component from the queue, right? And so this function calls, takes one component from the queue and it renders it. And then after that component is rendered, which is literally calling the component function, rendering a component is literally taking that function and calling it. React would, only after that call is done, React would go and check whether shoot yield to hosts returns true, whether it should return control to the browser. So what this means is if any single component takes, for example, not 5 milliseconds, but 500 milliseconds to render, the main thread would still be blocked for the full 500 milliseconds, even though it's the non-urgent update. That's because React has no way to interrupt rendering of a single component. You literally call the component function when you start rendering the component. You can't stop the function once you started executing it. And this is the third drawback of React concurrency. So to summarize, React concurrency is slower for non-urgent updates, more CPU expensive for all updates, and doesn't help with expensive components. But if you're willing to deal with these drawbacks and pitfalls, you'll get this almost magical behavior of rendering something huge and not slowing the page at all. Is this a meme? Maybe this is a meme. That is React concurrency and how it works under the hood. Thank you.
Perfect, Ivan, would you like to join me for a little conversation here?
That was literally precisely 35 minutes.
You timed it really well, I have to say. That's great. You like mockets?
Oh, yeah. May I take two? Like, just for now, just for now, just while I'm sitting here.
For now.
What?
For now. For now. Well, thank you so much for the wonderful session.
Inviting. Okay.
Sure. We have some questions that came up in the chat as well. One of them is guidelines on when to introduce concurrency. So once you, how do you know when you need it?
Good question. So that's actually a tricky question because like this is, let me phrase it. So like while like. Not everyone updated to React 18. And so yes. The stuff that I'm talking here is like the mental model that I'm using right now, but this mental model was not like kind of production tested with my clients. Like a lot of my clients still use React 17. So the thing that I'm using right now, the mental model that I'm using right now is like whenever I have some thing that I see and like, okay, I want to debounce this, or I want to throttle this, then I would take that, and if it's React 18, I would try to actually transition it so rapid with start transition. So that's one thing. Another thing, by the way, and it didn't fit into the talk, but another thing that I really like in React 18 is that if you're like if you have a server render top and it has it hydrates and hydration takes a lot of time because hydration always takes a lot of time, you can take some parts of the app and wrap it with suspense without any fallback. And that would make these parts of the app also hydrate in this like concurrent mode, so like giving the control back to the browser all the time. And that's super, super good for your Lighthouse score and the total blocking time metric.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's been an interesting couple of conversations also happening about the performance. So we've been having a lot of conversations about React performance over the years, saying, well, we introduced this notion of single page application, and the only thing we see is loading spinner all the time, especially on. Anybody feels like that? A little bit, maybe. So where are we at this point? So I mean, over the last like 5-7 years, right, when we kind of really moved, well, longer than that, I think now, when we moved to single page applications, do you think that we are in a position right now where given the tooling, the techniques, the what React is capable of, or other frame, like kind of Vue and so on for that reason, do you think that we're in a position where we can make extremely fast React applications?
No. I don't know. Honestly, if you need something to be really fast, go with Vanilla or go with Svelte or go with Preact. Like these are frameworks that are like specifically optimizing for like they're playing the short term game of performance. Like they're trying to squeeze all the like milliseconds, all the bytes, and they're really good at this. What React seems to me like an external observer, what React is trying to do. Is it tries to play this long game of reinventing the concepts. So like you see, it took them 4 years to release the concurrent features. They have to like introduce hooks, they had to, release Fiber first, and then like release finally this stuff. And they're working on the off-screen API, and they have this like huge, they also have like several components. So they have this huge long-term vision, which is basically how do we make developers fall into the pit of success? So like, how do we make developers write fast code by default? And so like, Preact, Svelte, stuff like that, they also focus on that. But I feel React's vision is kind of more grander level. I'm not sure whether it would work out. Yeah. But yeah, if you today you need to write apps for like embedded clients or something, don't take React.
Yeah, so that brings to, I mean, maybe just a few more minutes and then we'll probably wrap up. I know that many of you might be hungry at this point. Do you think that we are in this world right now? So I remember vividly when jQuery was everywhere. Mm-hmm. It still is, actually. The vast majority of websites are driven by jQuery. But do you think that we will see this movement, the transition at some point? Interesting. Where we will be, do you think that we will be in a position at some point where we'll be saying, oh, you know, in the back days, good old days, we were using React, but we don't do it anymore? Or do you feel like React is on a good kind of trajectory to become the standard for, you know, enterprise applications or just really complex advanced applications?
I don't know. I could, I'd be humble and say I have no idea. I don't know. I was like, I started developing when React was already out there and jQuery was already on the fall. So like, honestly, I have not seen how jQuery did it, and like, I haven't lived enough to see.
Okay, that's okay. That's fair enough. Okay, maybe just one more thing because this came up, and that would be probably the last one. Mm-hmm. So you showed React DevTools. Is there any other tooling that you'd highly recommend for React developers just to be aware of?
Yes, so there are a bunch of my favorites. So one thing, if you go to my Twitter, which is, well, it's not there anymore, and search for tweets, right? No, nobody's going to do that. But anyway, I have a thread with a bunch of my favorite performance non-React tools. And like it's just a bunch of obscure tools, or like not necessarily obscure, but like not super popular tools, which I find really, really useful. And specifically for React, two of my favorites. All right, maybe one my most favorite tool is the library called YDTRender, which is basically it's a tool, it monkey patches React, and it tells you why this or that component has rendered, mm-hmm. which is like, look, this object was the same, like this object looked this before the render, this object looks like this after the render, and this is something React Profiler does not show you.
Yeah.
So like, I use it all the time.
Oh, that's cool. Anything else that seems like a good start of a very long, good list?
Okay, use.
If not, you can also point to Twitter or maybe just tweet it.
Well, I know there's a use YDT update hook, which like is like YDT render, but it's copy pastable and easier to add.
I mean,
okay, nothing.
That's okay. If you come up with some, that'd be great. All right, I think that's great. Is there maybe just one final thing? Is there a particular one feature or one thing that you would like React to have, or you'd like to React to move at some point, which would make your life as a React developer much easier?
Honestly, they have so many bugs in the React Profiler, and I keep failing to raise them. I would love them to fix the bugs, but I need to raise these bugs. So,
okay. Well, you know, we have the rest of the day here, so.
Yes.
Excellent. Well, if you have a bit of time, you can also go ahead and join Ivan in the Smashing Stand after this, just for a little chat. I know that we're going to have a break, but if you want to, I'm sure you'll share everything you know over
I'm
there.
Happy to talk everything performance. Just hit at me with anything.
CSS?
Especially with Candice.
CSS?
CSS performance, maybe, depending on what.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, with this in mind, thank you so much, Ivan, for being with us.
Thank
it's a
you.
Pleasure to have you here.